Good morning, everyone. This is Aishwarya Hiremar from KLE College of Pharmacy from Department of Pharmacy Practice, Belagavi. So today we are going to study a new topic on drug information. So drug information, so it is nothing but providing clinically relevant information. So be it on any aspect of drug use, that is whether it is formulation, composition, or the ingredients or the quantity of the drug or which time to be taken, frequency. So it gives information about the drug use, that is how it should be used, when it should be used, and what are the precautions to be taken so that less interactions takes place. So it gives us general basic information so on how we can use the drugs properly and how we can make the best use of it in various population, that is in pediatrics, adults and geriatric population. So to give the drug information, pharmacists, they have a unique knowledge, that is they have the knowledge of the all kinds of drug category and classification of the various drugs and which drug works best in which patients, and they have a lot of skills with experience, so which helps in giving the drug information. And drug information sources, it is available in various ranges, that is it is available in formats, media types and level of quality. So you all might have commonly encountered that whenever you purchase any medicines, that time you just check it on internet, type the name of medicine in Google and all, and just check it for what it is used and all. So that is one of the source, but it is not clinically relevant, because these Google sources and all those sources, what they do is whatever the information they get, just club it and add. So that is not relevant source. So always you have to get the information from relevant sources only. That is, this drug information, it is categorized as follows, that is primary resources, secondary resources and tertiary resources. So let us study one by one. So primary, as name itself suggests, it should be used at the primary, that is mainly it includes the results of the research at all levels and also clinical experience in the form of individual responses to the drug and small case series. That is whenever new drug that comes into market or investigational new drug, that time it goes into various phases. So at various research levels when it undergoes, so there are various adverse reactions and all, and how it responds in a person. So at all levels it gives us source of information. So there are various studies, that is research studies, that is cohort studies or cross-sectional or randomized control study. So when we do that, so that we'll get to know the information. So any new drug before coming into market, so that is needs to be tested in human, that is at small patients at a particular given small population. So it gives us information. So primary reports, mainly in that we can get the information of any drug. And mainly when it is published, that is especially in a good reputed journal, which is Scopus indexed or good indexed journal. So that gives us information. So mainly, usually when we go for checking this drug information, what we do? Mainly adverse effects, adverse drug reaction reports we check. That is mainly ADRs, that is what the drug might cause, that is possible adverse reactions caused by a drug. So that can be checked with this drug information, that is primary drug information. So individual reports are available. So in that we'll get to know the adverse drug reaction, possible adverse drug reactions. Next is secondary, mainly review reports or primary reports that which is submitted. So that in that also we can get information. So it can be also informal. So mainly the one who is specialist in that field, that is say dermatology and all, in that field, so mainly this can be sought, and mainly when you go through the literature studies and all, there also you can get, and narrative and review and systemic review and meta-analysis when you go through this, that is analysis of various articles when they are clubbed together. So that will give you a information of drugs, and it also, the secondary resource also includes electronic knowledge system like Micromedics. So Micromedics is one of the electronic system in which we can get the information, and Lexicomp as well. It, suppose if you type a drug name, that is suppose take metformin, so it gives us all information, that is drug monograph, in what formulations it is available, in whether it is available in topical or not, and whether it is safe in pregnancy, that is various categories of pregnancy or not. So it gives us all information. So this is a standardized, so this is standardized Micromedics and Lexicomp, so which will give information on, that is clinically relevant information based on all the reports and all, when they are clubbed together, when you get a proper conclusion, so that information is put up in this. So this is a standard source where you can get the information on drug. So always you have to use standard resources for getting in drug information. Next is tertiary, that is mainly tertiary is nothing but both summaries of this primary resource and secondary resource. So it gives us more data, that is it is more comprehensive when you club it together, and it is slow revision than other resources. Example, published textbooks are available when they go through primary and secondary. So when they club together and they publish in textbook, because it is a slow resource, because it takes time to review and see. So like that, there are various published textbooks available, that is AHFS, that is American Health Formulary System, or Martindale, that is drug reference or drugs in pregnancy and lactation, and British National Formulary. So whatever the information of primary and secondary resources, when they are clubbed together by studying, and when clinically relevant information is clubbed together, that gives us tertiary resources. So that's it about drug information services. So you have to get information from the relevant source. Next is sources of report. So the reporting of ADR, that is how you can, there is different types of sources where you can report an ADR. Among that, individual reporting can be done. So mainly individual reporting is done by the doctor whenever you are admitted in hospital, or even you go to visit clinics for the routine checkup. So if they find out the ADR, so there they report. So mainly this practice is done in hospitals, and those whose practice is primarily outside. So mainly their time period might be prolonged, because we don't get to know the proper drug drug adverse event, and it might also be, they might also be seen, that is slow occurrence or delayed reactions can also be seen. So there are four types of ADR, type 1, 2, 3, 4. So there might be delayed reactions also. And mainly most severe reactions, they are seen in hospital, that is inpatient physicians. So they are not able to get the like previous administration. So they can link it to the reaction, that is they might correlate it with the any drug that is causing the reaction, or which might be possible drug reaction, and then they can report. And physician, whenever they are undergo outpatient or inpatient, so they might be able to decide and justify whether this whatever the signs that patient is experiencing, and if there is any elevation or decrease in the laboratory data signs, so that can be correlated with the previously administered drug. So if it is giving the same results, then it can be reported. And even the one who is experiencing the adverse effects, so if he is from healthcare professionals and all, even he can report. So this is individual reporting. Next is comprehensive monitoring. So mainly in hospital settings, whenever a patient is admitted for very much prolonged period of time, and so mainly that time we can get to know the identification, that is we'll get to know the proper adverse
drug reactions of these. So it helps us to identify. That is, in hospital we can do comprehensive monitoring, because he will be admitted, we can get his past medications, present medications, and what medication is causing adverse effect, that will be got, like that can be rectified very easily. And patient reaction, that is whether the patient is getting a, for example, fixed drug eruption caused due to any drug, that can be easily identified, because it gives us comprehensive, because in hospital all data will be available and even laboratory setting will be there. So if there is any elevation, so we can get it quickly with the report. And specialized methods can be used, and this can be properly combined and can be supplied to the national center. Next is population. That is mainly overall population they monitor. Whenever this whole population is experiencing some similar kind of things, that is entire hospital or district or anything such. So mainly large system, largely it can be reported. So survey can be done. So example, now vaccination drive is going on, and the survey of vaccination can be done, that is adverse effect caused by vaccination and all those things. So this can be done. And as rapidly advances are being made, that is electronic patient documentation can is done in electronic media as well. So that will get to know proper drug monitoring can be done in population. So that will give you a proper graph in population. So this can be monitoring adverse drug reaction can be done in overall population. So this is population monitoring. It is complex because so many patients are involved, and population so might not be enough, because in population what happens if thousands of reactions are shown, then only it is reported. But some of them might be rare, it might show in one patient or two, that might be, you know, that might not be reported, we might miss out some more rare reactions. And other thing, that is mainly automatically record drug use and patient syndromes, the system. So mainly this helps in association, that is correlation between two. So whatever the results we get, that can be reported to the national center. Next is individual. So as name itself suggests, so individual, the document providing, that is complete information of about the individual from given time to time. So mainly this is provided by primary reporter, that is suspected adverse events. So mainly administration of one or more medicinal products to an individual patient at a particular interval of time. And next is spontaneous reporting. So mainly this spontaneous reporting system is like wherever the case reports. So whenever a drug is, whenever a patient takes a drug and he reports so and so. So individual case reports of this adverse drug reaction are voluntarily submitted by healthcare professionals or pharmaceutical companies or consumers. So it's spontaneous. So once he experiences, he will report. So this mainly suspected, they'll correlate with the suspected, and mainly this can be reported by patient as well. So these reporting can be communicated by any means. So there is system also, then there is with the yellow cards and red cards. So the key feature of this spontaneous report is it can be reported by even consumer also. So mainly this, whatever the reporting, should be more focused, because sometimes there might be confusion in reporting as well, because the patient might just report edema, that vague symptoms can be reported, but vague symptoms sometimes don't give us proper correlation with the disease or with the drug. So edema, we don't know the site, whether it is pedal edema or anything else. So that is one of the problem, because accuracy won't be there. So that is why proper, whenever a patient is reporting, proper identification it with the healthcare profession is very important. So with the help of healthcare professionals, when they report, then we'll get accurate, because only if patient reports, we might not get accurate results. And such reporting, it is mainly reported in spontaneously. So that is why it is called spontaneous. Next is cohort. So this is nothing but cohort in, that is large data, whatever, particularly in previously unrecognized, unsuspected, and
unassociated or associated risk can be got by this. So mainly cohort, so whenever patients are receiving this any medication largely together, so in that demographic, particular demographic data, we will get this we can do cohort event monitoring. So mainly this record requires proper records, that is record should be filled properly, and mainly this is established when the primary healthcare professionals, and it might mainly depending upon the country, the program might vary. So normally in cohort 10,000 it is sufficient to provide statistical numbers, but larger might be needed. So this is being described as prescription event monitoring. So prescription, so this is appropriate use, so it helps in cohort event monitoring. Thank you for patient listening.